All right. My name is Andrea Albright, and I'm a graduate student at the University of Houston. And I spent this summer working as a pathways intern with the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers at their field research facility in Duck, North Carolina, on the Outer Banks. And I collected data that was collected from this platform here that you can see. It's a three-story tripod that is called the Coastal Research Amphibious Buggy, which we also call the crab. And it can drive out into the wave in order to collect data. And this is a still frame from a GoPro video. So this is kind of how we normally think about waves. Nearshore oceanographers have been trying for years to measure wave motion in the natural environment. And so we, you know, even simple questions like how tall is the wave, how fast is it moving, and how steep does it get before it breaks, can be relatively challenging. And so normally we can think of looking at waves from the beach or from a boat or taking a video. Let me move away from the speaker. So here's a video of the waves. Right, so that looks really cool. But if I asked you how fast that wave is moving, you might have some trouble trying to, you know, extract the information from sort of like a 2D image. And the more traditional way of measuring waves is to put either a pressure or acoustic sensor underneath the waves, but then we really don't have any information about what's going on at the surface. And so we're using a technique called LiDAR. So LiDAR is an acronym that stands for light detection and ranging. And that is a way to visualize what's going on at the surface, where each data point is actually a 3D data point that we can use for analysis. So you can see up at the top of the frame, there's a little spinny doohickey. If you go to the next slide. So this is a Velodyne HGL32 sensor. It spins around 360 degrees and can shoot 32 individual lasers in less than 50 picoseconds. And it spins around at a rate of 10 hertz, so one revolution every tenth of a second. And that translates to about 700,000 laser shots every second, and we get about 10,000 of those back. Next slide. Right, so up here at the top of the screen, we see the lasers coming out. Next one. They go down further until they reach the surface of the wave. Okay, so what we're doing is we're measuring the amount of time that it takes the lasers to reach the surface and come back to the laser scanner. And that's what we call the two-way travel time. So the two-way travel time is proportional to the distance. So if we measure that time very, very exactly, and we multiply it by the speed of light and divide it by two, that is a measurement of the range. Okay, and here you can see an example of what it looks like when we put the LiDAR data on top of our 2D image. So this is kind of how we normally think about looking at waves, and this is just the data put on top of it. So this is the exact same data frame, right, where each one of these data points is a 3D data point. Okay, and I want to kind of orient you. So before we were looking out at the ocean, so here's our cross-shore position. Cross-shore means you're looking perpendicular to the shoreline, okay, and your positive values are looking out at the ocean. Negative values are pointing back towards the shore. And this is our longshore position. So if you were walking along the beach, that's the longshore dimension. Okay, and then we also have an elevation bar here. Notice the elevation values are negative. That's because 0, 0, 0 is actually the location of the laser scanner. So when it says -5 meters elevation, that's -5 meters beneath the laser scanner. All right, so one of the major advantages of LiDAR is that we can look at this from any angle that we want. Once we have a 3D data point, we can observe it from any position. And in fact, there are some things that are much easier to observe from the top down, But sometimes we want to be able to look at it from a side view. So this is an example of a cross shore profile. And as I said before, positive values, here we're looking out to sea. Negative values, we're looking back towards the shoreline. All right, so I'm gonna show you some examples of two different types of waves. So this is, these are the exact same data points, just from two different perspectives. So down here is a cross shore profile, and here we're looking at it from more of a perspective. This is an example of a spilling wave. We call it a spilling wave because at the point of breaking, water and foam spills down the front of the wave. And I can show you a movie. So every one of those data points is a data point that we can use for making a measurement. Okay. And the next one. So the other type of wave that I want to talk about is called a plunging wave. So a plunging wave is what you think of when you're going surfing, you know, like it has that nice peel to it. So a plunging wave happens when the top of the wave moves somewhat faster than the body of the wave, and it curls over, and so you get that nice peeling effect. And so what we're looking for to characterize this wave is this apparent void, right? And the only reason why we can see this void in the LiDAR data is because, so you can see this, the blue data here corresponds to returns from the arm of the wave, and then the red parts right here is where you're actually seeing the front face of the wave. So because we have this alongshore resolution, we can actually see different parts of the wave at the same time, and that's how we can visualize that void. So watch the video. So that's a plunging wave. Specifically because we want to look for that void, and we want to be able to see what's happening in the alongshore dimension, we came up with a way to smoosh the lasers together. So if you go to the next slide. So this is the exact same wave as before, but now this bottom plot is now a density plot. So all 32 lasers have been concatenated together, and now we can look at that wave, but we're just able to see the density of data in the cross-shore profile as a function of cross-shore and elevation position. Okay, so I've been talking a lot about looking at waves in the spatial domain, right? And I want to introduce a type of plot that we look at in the time domain, but I want to make sure that you guys are with me. So just to reiterate, when we're looking at LiDAR data, what we're measuring is the amount of time it takes for a laser shot to hit a target and come back. So then when we measure the distance, if we know the location and orientation of the instrument when it fires, then we can know the XYZ location and time of every single data point that we take. All right, so this is an example of a cross-shore profile from one laser. And so we're still in the spatial domain here. So this is perpendicular to the shore, and this is elevation. And so if we look at all 32 lasers at once, we can see a snapshot of the surface at any point in time. All right, but we're still in the spatial domain. So this is along the beach, and this is perpendicular to the shoreline, okay? But if we, so can you go back one? So if we take this profile from one laser, and go forward two. Next one. And we look at it from, instead of looking at it from the side, we're looking at it from the top now, and we're coloring it by elevation. So blue areas are areas of low elevation, and the red is the crest, right? And each line is one scan of the sensor, and so we're moving in time from left to right. So this is one wave, and this plot here is what we call a time stack. So that, next one. So the next plot, so that was just one wave, so it's about 5 seconds worth of data. This is 3 minutes worth of data. And so we can see individual waves relatively clearly, right? So here's a wave, here's a wave, here's a wave. And you can see the areas in between the waves. And we can also measure what the slope of these lines are, And that tells us what the cross-shore wave speed is. So that tells us how fast the wave is moving onshore. And this plot is maybe not super intuitive at first, so maybe the best way to think about it is when we're at some point in time, we're looking out. So here's the cross-shore profile. So this is towards the beach. This is looking out to sea. So if you're at one position in time and you're looking out to sea, you can see that the crest of the wave is way back here, but then we move forward a little bit, and then we look out to sea, and the crest has apparently moved forward. So that's the forward motion of the wave. So the shallower that line is, the slower the wave is moving, and the steeper the line is, the faster it's moving. All right, so going back to our individual wave profile, and remember that one of the real advantages of this technique is that we can look at the data from any angle we want to. So if we change our perspective a little bit, so we're moving in time from left to right. And if we start looking at it from a more perspective angle, we can start to see the individual scan lines. So each scan line is one rotation of the sensor, and we're just stacking them in time. All right, and this is our cross-shore position. So this is looking, this is from the beach looking out towards the ocean. And we're coloring this, so this is sort of an area of low elevation, and you can see the crest of the wave. Another one. So at this perspective, you could actually look down the barrel of the wave, and you can see kind of what its shape is in both space and time. And part of our motivation for this research is we want to be able to correlate how waves are breaking at the surface and how much energy they're introducing into the water column, and then also be taking concurrent measurements underneath the waves so that we know how the water is moving underneath the surface. And then if we can also tie that to sediment transport, so how much sand is being introduced into the water column with different types of waves, and we can measure that through time, then we can start to talk about coastal erosion. So what kinds of waves are contributing to coastal erosion, and what types of waves might be bringing more sand back up on shore. So I guess I want to thank NASA for giving me this opportunity, and I would like to also thank all of the people working at the FRF, and Catherine Brody, who's my supervisor, and Preston Hartzell and Craig Glennie at the University of Houston. So, thank you.